So as we continue to cover pressing issues that rear their ugly head in a civilization and culture that is shifting at breakneck speed, there are few issues more important than the idea of private property and land use. And you would think that this would not be an issue for anybody. But you'll be shocked to hear about what's happening even here in the United States with land use and federal government purchasing up land for nefarious purposes that are tied directly to control, power, and a climate agenda. My friend Marlo Oaks joins us, the Utah State Treasurer, along with Margaret Byfield, who I just recently met, a policy expert in this field. You're going to learn something new and very important here. This episode is brought to you by Fathom the Good. Fathom the Good is homeschooling high school curriculum that teaches teenagers the best ideas underlying our Western civilization focused on the American founding. I believe these are the best classes your kids will ever take from kindergarten through seniors in high school. And you know what? Depending on where they go, even beyond into the universities. If you go to fathomthegood.com, you can check out their free sample courses. Here we go. All right, welcome to Cwic Show. My name is Greg Mattson, and I am your host. In this episode, we bring on Marlo Oaks, the Utah State Treasurer, and Margaret Byfield, Executive Director of American Stewards of Liberty and a Natural Resource Policy Expert. Welcome to the show.
Hey, thank you.
Margaret, we're going to start with you. This is, by the way, to me, very concerning topic. I am really surprised that this is not being discussed more. But let's start off with this very basic, broad question. What is 30 by 30? What is this?
So 30 by 30 is an international agenda to permanently protect 30% of our lands and oceans by 2030. Now, it's been implemented in other nations, many, 20 plus years in front of us. And it really wasn't able to get established here in America until the Biden-Harris administration came in. And 6 days into the start of that administration, they initiated the 30 by 30 agenda in America through executive order, through presidential fiat. And so what 30 by 30 really means, what they are after is they are saying we're in a nature crisis. And to solve that, we must set aside 30% of our lands in their natural state, meaning no human use, no food production, but left to nature in order to save humanity. So that's their argument. And it's all tied into the climate crisis narrative. And so in America, it was very difficult for them to get this established because we're very different from other nations. We actually own our property. You know, we don't have a sovereign king. The individual is sovereign. And so when we own our property, we own our property. And in America, 60% of the land is still owned by the people. So that's one of the big hurdles that they've had is how do they get control of our private property when the people own it, as opposed to other nations where you have kings that own it or the governments that own it. And it's a lot easier to put in policies to say, hey, you now need to set aside land 30%. So it really took a very aggressive administration that wasn't so concerned about following the law to get this implemented in America, because a couple things about 30 by 30, it's unauthorized. There's no congressional authority.
What does that mean, it's unauthorized?
It means there's no congressional authority for it, and there's no constitutional authority for it. So a directive like this, a national environmental policy to set aside 30% of the land, would need to be something that Congress passed and the states agreed to. But none of that happened. They just did it through executive order. So they have been implementing it. They've been using the existing programs and the existing funds that they already had authorized in order to implement this on American soil. So we've seen over the course of their administration, we've seen everything from a real increase in conservation programs because they create a federal nexus on the private lands. We've seen a huge increase in conservation easements. That's another thing that permanently protects the lands that qualifies under 30 by 30. And then we've seen them really lock down lands that the federal government already owns. So like our multiple use lands that are managed by the Forest Service and the BLM. We've seen them really lock those things down and restrict them to the point that the BLM has just issued finalized a rule where they now are going to be giving conservation leases instead of grazing leases or timber sales or any of those things on our, what are supposed to be our productive lands that we, the people, get to use and support our economies from.
Now, do they really need does this need to be authorized? I mean, doesn't the government just go out, the federal government, and say, well, we're going to go out and we're going to purchase this land, or we're going to set this land aside? And I don't know. I mean, it's kind of like a zoning of this land. If it's BLM or anything else, do they have to authorize this in order to accomplish this?
The Constitution delegates Congress to be the manager of our federal holdings, not administrative agencies. So Congress has delegated some of that authority to the administrative agencies. But to put it in perspective, whenever there is a special use category or lands are to be set aside for a special use, like say a national park or a wilderness area or a national wildlife refuge, those are designated by Congress. So that is our representative body goes, deliberates, and decides this is very special land. We want to protect it. We're going to make it a park, and they withdraw it and they make it a park. But that is done through our representative government. What we've seen in the Biden-Harris administration is they're not going that route. What they're doing is, as we've seen here in Texas most recently, is they issued a new land protection plan, an acquisition area that they have self-designated around a 6,440-acre national refuge. There's no acquisition area around it now that Congress designated, and sometimes they will on a national wildlife refuge. There isn't one on this, so they self-designated it, and their acquisition area is 7 million acres. Covers 15 counties in Texas and 5 in New Mexico, and out of that, they are planning to acquire 700,000 additional acres in private fee simple land, so they convert that to federal, or in conservation easements. So again, up until the Biden-Harris administration, those are things that Congress has delegated. So whenever they're making a special designation of land, they're withdrawing it from the public domain to be utilized as multiple use lands. That has been Congress's decision in the past. This administration has decided that they are going to self-authorize themselves through their administrative agencies to take what land they want to acquire without that authorization.
Margaret had brought up that this is kind of tied in with the climate change initiatives. Is it? I mean, it seems to me like these types of things are always led with kind of this bleeding heart, compassionate type of agenda of, well, we've got to protect the wildlife, we've got to protect the environment, pollution, the ozone layer, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. Right? These things get piled up on this. How much of this land acquisition by the government is really a sincere effort to control things, I guess, from an environmental perspective? And if it's not, if there's a percentage of that's not, what is the purpose of this?
Well, I think we're seeing the use of crisis narratives to really push agendas. The biggest, like Margaret said, is the climate change. This is really at the heart of things like environmental social governance in the corporate world. This is clearly what's driving this 30 by 30 agenda. This really originates from the UN, 30 by 30. So it is. It kind of all roads lead back to this climate crisis narrative, and so absolutely, that this is really using that an existential threat to try and push people to do things that otherwise we wouldn't do. And in this case, protection. We're talking about protecting land. Well, that sounds really nice. Except for it's really more like walling off land. It's basically taking land away from us, and I think people need to understand that really this isn't about protecting land as much as it is about controlling land and stopping human impact on land. And that's where it becomes very problematic because, you know, a big part of the United States and our founding was about private property. That is a key element that protects us from the government is our ownership of land. And so when we move into a government really trying to lock up and keep people off of land, we're talking about a very different country.
Margaret, going back to the Biden-Harris administration, back in 2020, there was a resolution filed in the House by filed by co-sponsored by Senator Kamala Harris and Representative Deborah Harland. Okay, this is fascinating to me. I think there were only 15 people involved with this, or representatives that were involved with this. It wasn't like really backed up much, but this would be during the election year. And I don't know if Senator Harris had already been chosen as vice president at this point to run with Biden. I mean, I would imagine this would have already been the case. I don't know. But I'm not a Washington insider, so I don't know a number of these things. But is there a connection between her involvement with 30 by 30 here, where she is pushing this 30 by 30 resolution, and her being brought into the administration? And what is the why is she involved in this? Is this because the Biden administration had tapped her as a senator to take a look at this as they were hoping to come into to the White House, or is it the other way around?
Yeah, I don't really know. You know, what came first? What we do know is that she's been a true believer on this agenda from the very beginning. So I think when I first saw that resolution that was filed, there were only five senators on it, and she was one of them. So like you said, it was not a popular idea. And it was just a resolution. They didn't even try to file it as a bill. But I think what it did was it probably set her up to signal to the powers that be that, you know, want these UN agendas adopted in America, to realize, okay, she's our gal because she's going to push these agendas. So, I do think that it probably was a very strategic decision to go forward with it. But, you know, they're true believers in this. And Deborah Holland, you know, she as a freshman representative co-sponsored it in the House, and now she's Secretary of the Department of Interior and has been throughout.
That's very
the administration. Yeah.
Like, wow. Wait a minute here. So one of the two sponsors is vice president, now running for president. The other sponsor is the Secretary of the Interior.
Yeah, exactly. And that tells us,
you know, again, I'm not going with a conspiracy here, but that just is kind of that's kind of interesting.
Well, and it also tells us that if Harris is to win the election, this is going to get worse for landowners in America.
Yeah, because this is how this usually would work. I know this much, right? She's got certainly ties with lobbyists and others that would be with organizations that are having her or helping to push her support this resolution, to push this through. Someone she's talking to, or numerous organizations that she's talking to with this, that she has ties with, that you would think she continues those ties with now. And so you would think that, yes, this is just going to become a bigger and bigger deal if she is going to be put in as president. So, Marlo, what, you know, there is, aside from the push for land goes beyond even the federal government. I mean, you've got Bill Gates buying up all of this property everywhere, and other land trusts, and all these things happening. They're buying all this property. There's no food being grown on it. There's no agriculture happening with it. There's no production of any sort that's going on where they're using, you know, the land uses in a positive manner at all. Why are they doing this? Why are they involved with the same type of thing? Are they helping to try and accomplish this 30 by 30, or what are they doing?
That's a great question, and I'm not sure I really have a solid answer. It is troubling when you have any organization or even other countries coming into our country, buying up land and then letting it sit fallow. I mean, that clearly is not in society's best interest. If we have agricultural land, it should be producing. That's how market works. If the market were truly, trying to meet the demands of society, then the land would be put to some kind of use that has benefit for society. And so to have large actors like large investors come in and buy up land and not use it for economic purposes, that clearly is a very troubling development, because it says that their agenda, that they are willing to bypass, economic benefits to push their agenda. It's very counter to what any of us would think would be in the best interest of that landowner. And so it should concern everyone in society when those kinds of activities are taking place and land is essentially being used as a pawn in this existential climate discussion. You're basically taking resources and making them unavailable for society, and it harms all of us.
Yeah, that is really interesting. And all three of us were at a meeting recently, and there was a statement. I haven't verified this, but there's a statement made that, and maybe one of you two can, but a statement made that we are now in the negative in terms of import and export on food. In other words, we import more food than we export at this point, which is a very odd thing if that is true, with so much land, open land that we have available for agriculture. That would be a very odd thing, a position to be in. Why would you ever want to be in that position? Of all things, food, you would think would be an important resource. Isn't that right, Margaret?
Oh, yeah, absolutely. And that is correct. I mean, the recent numbers that came out on our trade numbers is we are exporting less than we are importing. So we have become a net importer of food, America. I mean, we can grow everything here. We can raise everything here. We're not, a single market that just specializes in one product like some countries. We are so diverse that our resources are being locked up. And it is, I think it is very deliberate. And when you see the big players buying up the land, I really kind of liken them to our robber barons in the old days. They're the new climate crisis robber barons, because they're the same people like the Gates and the Jeff Bezos. They're the same people who are funding these real radical agendas internationally. So the 30 by 30 agenda, the attack on food, the eliminating beef and going to plant-based food products instead. They're behind all these things. At the same time, they're buying up our real assets, our land. And they're also people that don't have to make the land productive in order to survive. They already have a lot of money. So they can hold on to the land and starve everybody else out as they're in the cat's position to buy up this land as they're pushing other people off the land through these agendas like 30 by 30 and natural asset companies and the different things that we have had to fight over the last 4 years. So, I think there is a deeper agenda there. I think they do know what they're doing. And Marlo knows this, I'm sure. But if you want to become wealthy, you watch people who are wealthy. What are they doing? And what I'm seeing is they are buying up the real asset and they are not encumbering them with these federal conservation programs or conservation easements, like they're encouraging everybody else to do. And so one of the things that I think is that the real commodity of the future is going to be private property without these encumbrances. And that's what they're buying.
What is the relationship, would you say, between land and our liberty? What is the relationship there?
They are absolutely equal. You can't have one without the other. And this is what makes our nation so unique. And our founders understood this, that after, passing the Constitution, and it's obviously we're given rights that other countries don't have, but there are other countries that have similar constitutions to ours. The difference is our founders understood that it was only a piece of paper unless they gave us a way to protect it. And so the way that that was to be protected is that the people would own the land. If the people own the land, the people can control their own livelihoods. They can grow their own food, do all the basics, grow their own food, support their own family, defend their property, and at the same time, contribute to the economy. So build a strong local economy, which then builds a strong national economy. And having that ability, then they could limit government, which was always the intent of the founders. The founders never looked at government as a good thing. The Constitution is all about how do we put as many constraints on the federal government as possible so that they never overtake the power of the people. So key to that was the people had to own the land. And to put it in a modern perspective, look at the two wars we're in right now. Russia and Ukraine, what is that about? That's about more land. Israel, that's about more land. So all of the others understand, our opponents understand that who owns the land controls the government. You know, another way to put that in perspective is when Jefferson made the Louisiana Purchase, 540 million acres. Every acre of that was disposed of to the people. And he didn't call up the Bill Gates of the world and say, how much do you want? Or China. Every acre was disposed to the settlers, and it was proportionate to the area that they were settling in. So they could settle maybe in one state, it'd be 120 acres, because that's what you needed to have an economic unit to feed a family. In other places, it could have been 640 acres. But there was a limit on what a settler could acquire, because as Jefferson said in a great letter that we've published many times over the years because it's one of my favorites, but he said, it's the small landowner that is the most important part of the state. And if the land is dispersed among the people and not owned by a conglomeration or consolidated, then the people will always be able to control their government. And we, the people, will always have the ability to self-rule, which of course is the DNA of America. Yeah. So when you talk about land, you have to talk about liberty. You cannot have one without the other.
Well, and just I'll add to that, you know, this is really highlighting our economic system is bottom up. It's very different from other countries. You know, we got away from sort of this top down structure in Europe. We come to America and really trying to protect the individual, and it's the individual rights that are God-given. We are sovereign as individuals. In the marketplace, it's the same thing. The marketplace is really driven by consumer decisions, and what we're seeing now is this top-down effort to control resources, to control who gets capital, and same thing in the land, these land issues, when we're talking about coming in and grabbing huge swaths of land and taking it out of basically public use. You can see that this is clearly a top-down agenda. And again, it's justified by this existential threat that we're all going to die unless we do X, Y, and Z. And so hopefully, you know, people will start seeing this for what it is. And it's not just happening in the land. It's happening with corporations and the government coming in and or activist shareholders coming in and telling companies you have to do X, Y, and Z, which clearly not in the best interest of shareholders. You know, we're turning so many of our institutions upside down. And it really is basically bringing in a top-down element that is completely counter to our economic system and certainly what's in the best interests of individuals and our freedom ultimately.
Marlo, there was recently, I think it was squelched back in January earlier this year, but there was an effort to get something passed called the Natural Assets, was it securities?
Companies.
Mm-hmm. Natural Asset Companies. Okay, so Natural Asset Companies, that would be formed as a security, I believe, right? And it was used in a way that was, you know, it could be any kind of land and there would be value attached to this. I think that this is important to understand because of what's now being brought to us, which is the Sustains Act. But tell us a little bit more about those NACs.
Yeah, so this was, and this is why I got involved is because it is in the capital markets. And as state treasurer, I operate in the capital markets and oversee investments for the state. And so what happened was the New York Stock Exchange went to the Securities and Exchange Commission requesting a rule. And that rule would essentially allow these companies to manage land. They didn't have to own the land. They could just manage the land to maximize basically Mother Nature, ecological services. So they needed a rule because it requires different accounting. It's not, you know, the value of the company isn't based on traditional economic activity. It's based on what is the value of public goods like clean air and soil composition, things that we think of as just common everyday sort of positive public goods that don't have a value placed on them because there's not economic activity associated with them. And so when the New York Stock Exchange requested that rule, the implications were huge, because if this were allowed, then a company could be formed and capital could be raised from investors. Any investor that could invest in the United States today could invest in such a company. And that money could then be used to lock up land, essentially taking this money and buying the management rights to land. They don't have to buy the land itself. You could take a national park or you know, federal a BLM or Forest Service land and say, okay, this natural asset company is now going to manage it for the purpose of maximizing Mother Nature. You could also do this with conservation easements, private land. You could enroll that conservation easement on private land in a natural asset company, which then that company would manage that land for ecological purposes.
But maximize the land, natural resources, is that from production?
No.
Or just an intrinsic made-up value?
Yeah, it's basically trying to maximize, for example, photosynthesis and the production of clean air or pollination or any kind of natural process that's happening on land. That's really what they're talking about and trying to create a value for that. And so that there is now this artificial market that's been created for things that you and I would think of as just common everyday public goods that shouldn't be valued. Because once you value that, once you quantify and put some value on these public goods, then they can be bought and sold and traded and people can be charged for them. It opens up a Pandora's box that could be incredibly dangerous. And so I was very grateful that the New York Stock Exchange ultimately pulled the rule. And so the natural asset company did not come to fruition. But we're seeing the same themes of trying to basically lock up land to prevent human impact. Because one of the worst parts about the natural asset company is you have land today, for example, in Utah, we have about 67% of our land that's owned by the federal government. And we have multiple leases on land. It could be for mineral extraction or oil extraction or grazing, recreation, whatever it is. That could all happen on that land with these different leases. With a natural asset company, the goal would be to prevent that kind of economic activity, because it is completely counter to maximizing ecological services, maximizing the value of Mother Nature.
But there is no value to the ecological services.
Well,
there's no, how is that? I mean, I understand, for example, you've got solar energy and you create panels and you're creating energy out of it. There's something being produced from nature, right? But
yes,
you're talking about actually putting an economic value on the process of nature that does not produce anything specific for anyone to purchase.
Well, and frankly, these are invaluable, right? I mean, if we don't have trees that are involved in photosynthesis, then we're not going to have enough oxygen. So clearly there is value, but it's not traditional economic value, where you have money exchanging hands, right, and assigning value that way, which is basically what our economic system is based on. And sure. So that was the argument, that we're not valuing nature enough. And so therefore we need to put a value on it, because otherwise we're going to destroy nature and we're all going to die. It's sort of that same idea.
But is it putting a value on it, or is it controlling it? Because
they go hand in hand.
We're going to own these securities. Who owns the securities that actually produce oxygen, as an example?
Right.
Right. Well, these are producing the oxygen for the earth, and we own it.
Yes.
Right. And how many millions of acres can we own with the NACs, where we have, you know, hey, here's 1% of the total production of oxygen on the earth, and it's owned in a security. That is really concerning to me.
Oh, it's a huge problem. And on the other side, you could see companies being forced. Maybe it's an oil company or somebody that has a lot of large carbon footprint. They could potentially be forced to invest in a natural asset company to offset their carbon footprint, right? And so you can see how this market could be artificially created. But you're right, it opens up a Pandora's box that then allows buying and selling and trading and charging people for these goods that today are just common benefits for all of us because we live on this planet.
Yeah, Margaret, you were going to follow up with that.
Yeah, I think so. I think the fundamental flaw in what they're trying to do by monetizing these natural assets is these assets don't qualify as property. So property that can be bought and sold is something very specific. A very simple way to understand it is it's something that can be contained and something that you can exclude others from. So land, you can contain and you can keep people off. Water, you can contain, you can decide who gets to utilize that. Even the energy from solar panels, whoever produced that, that is their property, and they get to decide whether they're going to sell it and who they're going to sell it to if they decide to do that. But we're talking about things like air and pollination and photosynthesis, things that you cannot contain and you cannot exclude others from. So that's where we really cross the moral line by trying to kind of backdoor make these things at the same level as real property rights that somebody can own and somebody can control. And what that and the other part of that too is that is another reason why it's not property is because the value of it isn't derived by the consumer. So it's not derived because the consumer wants to buy it, that they're going to go into their grocery store and say, hey, I want to buy some carbon credits today. That's not a product people buy. The only reason that carbon credits are sold is for the reason that Marlo just discussed. Companies are forced into having to do that in order to be able to get a permit or to operate. So it's been manufactured, the value for it has. And as he talked about the New York Stock Exchange needing these unique accounting rules, they needed to adopt a UN accounting system, which basically is a methodology that has bureaucrats sitting in a room deciding that the air you breathe is worth X, the air Marlo breathes is worth Y, and the air I breathe probably has a completely different value. And that is going to change. That value is going to change based on who's sitting in the White House, not based on what the consumer wants to buy or sell. So that's why we kind of have to get back to the fundamentals on this. These are not property. And when we give them the color of property and interject them into our markets, we create real problems, not only for property rights, but for our economic system as well.
Marlo, was this something that was close at all, or was it easily squelched? Or, I mean, I remember, you know, we talked about this actually, I think end of last year, and before it had gotten squelched. But was it close? Was it a massive threat? Was it just a little bit of a threat? And where did it end up?
Oh, I think it was a massive threat. I think only because of folks like you who talked about it and got other people, more people, you know, learned what was going on. That ultimately, the message got out, and the consequences, people started understanding the consequences, and ultimately it was the New York Stock Exchange that pulled the rule, thankfully. I was very concerned that unless they did that, if it went through the whole process and got up and going, I mean, it could create a lot of problems, even if ultimately they stopped trading. You know, it was a very, very difficult situation. We had no idea, you know, where things were at, and we just had to, you know, go out and talk as much as we could on it. And thankfully, that the message got to the New York Stock Exchange. But we're clearly seeing that this effort to lock up land, to push this ecological, you know, valuation and putting a value on Mother Nature, this is not going away. These efforts to really change private property ownership in America, this is not going away. They're all related, and you know, more people need to understand what's going on.
Margaret, talking about it not going away, there's now the Sustains Act. Can you cover that a little bit? Tell us what this is. What are they trying to accomplish? Is it the same thing? I had brought up that maybe this is kind of like NAC's 2.0. What yeah. is it?
So Sustains Act is actually a Republican-led bill that was passed in the 23 Omnibus Appropriations Bill. And I think on the surface, it's one of these ideas that kind of sounds good on the surface. But now, in light of NAACS and that whole battle, I think I would guess that some of the people who voted for that bill are wishing they had not, because it was hard to foresee where this was all going. But what the Sustains Act does is it allows a contributing entity, a private entity, to contribute to the federal conservation programs that then are placed on private property to help landowners do more, do better with their land, mitigate the climate crisis. I mean, all these climate smart ideas is all wrapped into these conservation programs. And so the conservation program creates a federal nexus on the private land. That's one of the first concerns. But now that you have private money being interjected into these programs, the act itself directs the secretary to figure out now who owns the environmental services. So what we were just talking about that they were trying to do with NAACS was monetize those natural processes. This is like a backdoor way of accomplishing the same thing, because the statute says that the contributing entity is supposed to prescribe the percentage of those environmental services they now own on private land because they contributed funds to the conservation programs. And that valuation and that percentage is determined between the Secretary of the Interior or of USDA Agriculture and the contributing entity. It is not determined with the landowner. So you have them creating a financial structure, basically validating a new property right on somebody's private land that the landowner doesn't have a say in on what that's going to be. And that's where we, again, are crossing that line. It's a very dangerous line that we're crossing by saying we're going to monetize these natural processes and somebody is going to own them. And so, you know, proponents of this idea like to say, well, we're just, you know, we're kind of making it sound a little bit more extreme. And of course, you know, this wouldn't be used to control the property, but it absolutely is tailor-made to do exactly that. And again, it all comes down to who's sitting in the White House. And if it's a Harris administration, we are in for a very troubling 4 years. And it's just a matter of time before they get complete control of the property.
So this is to both of you then. I'm going to ask again, coming back to this, because this is what most people are going to say. And whether you're on the left or the right, many people are going to say, well, this is all just a conspiratorial idea. There's no real threat in place. We're not going to lose our property. What is the big deal? There's been parks and national, you know, BLM and everything for a long, state-owned property for a very long period of time. What is the big issue? So the question I have, I always like to go back and look at what the motives are and what the power structure is, because power is power. And if power is there, it's going to happen. That's just the way it works. If the power is given, it's going to happen. So the question is how much of this really is sincere about the environmental issues on this, again, and how much of it is a power grab? Is this really all about, we want to own the property as much as possible, whether it's a federal issue, right? The federal government wants to own all of this property because they want the power. And if so, what is the purpose of the federal government wanting to own all of this power? What does that do?
Well, I think, you know, we can go to Klaus Schwab, who is really the head of the World Economic Forum. And he has said it very plainly, we will own nothing and we will like it. You can go right to Karl Marx when he defined socialism. It's the abolishment of private property. I mean, our opponents understand, those who seek power and money understand that in order for them to have control of all of that, they need to take the private property away from us serfs. I mean, we're the little people. That's absolutely essential for them having the kind of control that they really seek over the rest of us, is they have to acquire the private property. So you have all these little kind of schemes on how they're going to get there. And that also, though, then you do have people involved in this movement who are true believers, who really believe, you know, man is destroying the environment. And I think they honestly believe that. I disagree with it, but I think that there are some out there that honestly believe that. And they are the ones who are really being used as kind of the patsies in all this. It's their emotional fervor behind this that is driving a lot of this. And those who are controlling the strings are making good use of that. So, you know, you have a lot of different agendas coming together with different motivations, but all working towards the same end goal. And, you know, really, this isn't anything new. I mean, our history shows us time and time again, you always have people who think that they are wiser, smarter, and should be dominating the rest of us. You know, Hitler, Napoleon. I mean, we've gone through this many times before. So this isn't something new. It's part of human nature. And that, again, gets us back to the brilliance of our Constitution, because our founders understood that's part of human nature. And they tried to put in as many safeguards as possible so that our government would never be controlled by people like that. So, you know, I think there's different ways to answer that. But there's one thing that my dad said that kind of puts it all in perspective and has put it all in perspective for me. And that is, either you have the right to own property or you are property. They understand that. We need to make sure we understand that and really fight to protect our property rights at every level. It's not just land. It's our gun rights. It's our freedom of religion. It's our freedom of speech. Those are all property rights. They are all absolutely invaluable to a self-governing nation.
Yeah. I think, you know, the reason I asked that question is because I think a lot of people don't understand that what you have in these kind of movements is a small group of powerful, dedicated, ideologically possessed individuals, right, that have the tools and they have the power and they have the know-how of how these things change and what you need to do. But the majority of people are somewhere in the spectrum from there out to, well, yeah, I mean, I don't like pollution. And that's where most people lie. So people think, well, there's not a real problem here. There is not this evil, because they're thinking of those individuals that are on that spectrum, that are listening to these things. But the problem is, people don't identify the source. They don't identify the sources of those that are the actual movers and shakers that actually make these things turn. And these individuals these are the theologians, so to speak, of these things. They are the ones that actually put all of the ideas out there. They're the ones that actually get things changed and move it. And they are the revolutionaries. They want revolution. Nobody else has to want that. They want the revolution. They know how to get it done. But this is why so many people look at this and they think, well, this is a conspiracy theory, or it's not, because I look around and I don't see these individuals as being these crazies and radicals that you're talking about. But it's all on a spectrum.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and I think one of the more interesting things that I've certainly learned is the power of language in getting people to adopt or to become proponents of something that could have some pretty negative consequences. So we're seeing the corruption of language in a lot of cases. You know, the powerful element of sort of the environmental movement is the, you know, language around stewardship and wanting to protect our resources and you know, these things that most everybody agrees on. The problem is that when you start digging deeper and you see what are they really trying to do, for example, in America the Beautiful, the 30 by 30 in America, we're talking about stopping human impact on the land, which is different than what most people would think they understand, right? Of sort of the message that's being talked about. And so that's where I think a lot of people get tripped up and people think, well, it's just about stewardship, but it's not. And that's, I think that's where I would say, you know, that's where people need to read more closely and look at more closely. What are the implications, whether the motives are pure or not? What are the implications for what they're, what is going to happen if we go in this direction? And that's really where I try to focus on is what are the implications here? And I don't necessarily need to know people's motives, although it becomes clear that somebody's motives are not positive here, right? They're trying to take over all this land. You know, it's really the language and understanding how terminology is being used to drive an agenda that really goes beyond what maybe people understand that terminology to mean. It's really the kind of having one word with two different definitions.
Yeah, you need a new language and understand what's being communicated. What you know, for both of you, what needs to be done here with all of this? I mean, for me, when I talk about these types of issues, I go all the way back to awareness. It's like the people need to be aware. Nobody knows about this. Nobody knows about these things that we're talking about right here. I didn't know about them until a year ago or so. Right? There's no awareness that these things are even happening. There's no awareness that there is a power grab. There's no awareness of honestly the importance of land ownership, even to that degree, right? We don't have that. So what I try to do is focus on awareness and education at a minimum. But is that enough? You know, what to say that we need to overhaul our education system is a truth, but that's a major issue. And to talk and say we need more civics and we need more understanding of liberty and the founding of the United States. But we are where we're at. Mm-hmm. And so it is awareness enough? What do we need to do?
Well, awareness, I think, is a good start. You know, our founder said we have to have an educated citizenry. And here's the thing that I actually think is more powerful about what we're doing. And just like conversations like this is, people recognize truth. Truth is a sword. And so you can, you know, make a strong case for all of this. And I know the groups that I talk to, it doesn't matter if they lean conservative or liberal. By the time we're finished, I mean, they're nodding their heads and they're going to walk out of that room. And the next time they hear a candidate say, well, we need to put in these conservation programs, the hair goes up on the back of their neck because they now know that may not be the right path. And so it's hard to really gauge how that's being multiplied. But I think definitely the educational component, I mean, programs like this are really important, but that also has to happen at every level, not just with the citizenry, but with our elected leaders as well. So, you know, as people get their arms wrapped around these issues, I think it's really important to make sure you're from the very local level, your county commissioners are aware of this. And that's one of the reasons that when we started fighting 30 by 30, we started with resolutions that counties asked counties to pass, not necessarily because it was going to stop it, but because it meant the whole community had to get organized and understand what 30 by 30 was to get behind it and stop it. And we know all these programs are implemented locally. So if a county, you know, you have a group of county commissioners that understands what 30 by 30 is, and they see programs come in, they know we need to fight this. And then you've got a chance. But that education, I mean, everything that we're talking about right here has to happen at every level of our policymaking. So the state level, and of course, that's where Marlo is, and he's done an exceptional job at bringing his colleagues up to speed. You know, through the NAC issue, he alerted so many of his colleagues, not just financial officers, but attorney generals that didn't have this awareness. And then we also do a lot of work back in DC, and we have a lot of policymakers in DC that are really, really understanding this in depthly. So I think, you know, is education enough? No, it's not enough, but it's a really good start. And we are building an educated citizenry around these truths. And at some point, you basically have to say the good Lord is going to, you know, help drive this ship as it's been doing it the whole time. And we do our part and we work tirelessly towards it. But I think, you know, we look at the NAC issue and how that was stopped. I mean, that definitely, from my perspective, was the hand of God was in that. And that was just one of those issues. He said, nope, you're not going to go this far. Yeah. And so I think we've seen that his work just this year actively in our nation when he stopped NACs. So I do think people have to get involved. I mean, there's another thing that my dad said that actually we are in the process of getting printed on a T-shirt because I think it's such a powerful statement that everybody needs to remember, which is you only have the rights you are willing to defend.
Sure.
So that's all of us. I mean, we can sit by and watch these things happen, or we can get involved.
Marlo, do you have any input on this to wrap us up here?
Yeah, I think, you know, we're talking about education and, you know, the term conspiracy theory is often used to discredit people. I really think one of the biggest challenges we have as a country is the pursuit of truth. Are we committed to pursuing the truth and finding what's real and what isn't? And that's a big part of education. And you know, our country was founded on pursuing the truth. Markets work based on information and the accurate flow of information and getting information into participants' hands. And it's up to us individually in each of our roles, whatever it is, that we are committed to pursuing the truth. And when you hear somebody say, oh, that's just a conspiracy theory, maybe that should be reason to start digging a little bit deeper and finding some of these documents that are out there. You know, that's where I had to go with the natural asset companies, really getting up to speed. A lot of the information was on government websites. You just read that and suddenly it's not a conspiracy theory. There's a lot of truth and that's really where we need to be committed. Instead of trying to tear each other down and saying, oh, you're just a conspiracy theorist, and maybe see if there's some validity there and looking and being committed to finding out what is accurate, what is inaccurate, and really being committed to some of these fundamental values that we as Americans have shared over the centuries of our country.
Yeah. Well, Margaret and Marlo, thanks so much for your time. Really appreciate it. I hope that we can do something like this again, follow up with what's going on, especially with the land use issues here. I think, again, it's just it's got to get out there. We've got to have people understanding what's going on and be educated in terms of, well, what am I going to vote for? What am I going to defend? What needs to be taught to my kids and my grandkids, et cetera? And so I appreciate your efforts on this.
Well, thank you for having us on.
Yeah. Yeah, and appreciate yours, too.
Thank you very
much.
Don't
underestimate what you're doing.
Yeah, it's very important. So thank you for your interest.
Thank you both.